This problem we're going to look at an ideal gas that we're going to continuously compress adiabatically. So this is a flow system. Inlet is at 2 bar and the outlet is at 7 bar pressure. Given the feed flow rate, given the heat capacity, which is constant for this gas. And the question is, what's the temperature of the gas that's leaving the compressor if we do it reversibly? And then if we were to do it irreversibly, in a system that required 20% more work than is required for the reversible process. So essentially we're looking at a compressor, I'll use that to represent a compressor, where we're adding work, and our inlet gas, 25 degrees C and 2 bar, outlet gas is at 7 bar, and we're determining what the temperature is, so let's call that T2, our unknown. So there's a relation between temperature and pressure when we do an adiabatic compression or expansion. And this relationship holds whether it's a flow system or a closed system. And that's at the final temperature, initial temperature. And keep in mind, of course, this has to be absolute temperature. The final temperature of initial temperature is related to the final pressure over the initial pressure raised to the gamma minus 1 over gamma power, where gamma is the ratio of heat capacities. Constant pressure heat capacity, the constant volume heat capacity. Now we're given Cp, but we know that there's a relationship for an ideal gas between Cp and Cv. And so therefore gamma is going to be 25, and this is joules per mole Kelvin, over Cp minus R, that's Cv. So again, 25 minus R, which is 8.314 in units of joules moles Kelvin. So if I calculate out, this is 1.50 to 3 significant figures. This equation, remember, is only true for a reversible expansion or compression. So we have all the information now. The only thing we're left to do is calculate the temperature, where the inlet temperature 273 plus 25 to convert it to Kelvin. 7 bar is outlet and 2 bar is the inlet. And then gamma is 1.5, so gamma minus 1 over gamma. So I'll do these numbers. And we calculate a temperature of 452 Kelvin leaving the reactor. This is the reversible compression. Remember, this is ideal gas. The temperature is increased from 298 to 452 Kelvin because we're putting work into the system, and that work is going to heat up the gas. To do the irreversible calculation for the temperature, first we're going to have to calculate the work. And so if we look at the first law, so we're still working with the reversible compressor. First law for a flow system, delta H is Q plus W. Since it's adiabatic, this is zero, so delta H is W. Well, ideal gas, we can calculate delta H. It's only a function of temperature. Since we have a constant heat capacity, it's just Cp delta T. Now let's put the numbers here. 25 joules per mole Kelvin, delta T, the final temperature in Kelvin, the initial temperature, we end up with 3850 joules per mole. So this is delta H for the gas, and therefore this is the work. And this is positive because we've done work on the system. We now want to calculate the irreversible work so we can get the temperature. So 1.2 times the reversible work because of what's given in the problem statement. So 1.2 times 3850, and I'll just carry out these calculations. So now we have the irreversible work. First law is the same for the system. Q is still zero. Irreversible work is going to be delta H for the irreversible process. That means delta H is 4620 joules per mole. Delta H, of course, ideal gas is still Cp delta T. Let's put in numbers for this. So inlet temperature is still 298, same heat capacity. So we can calculate the temperature for the irreversible process, 483 Kelvin. You'll note that this is higher than the temperature for the reversible process. We had to put in more work. More work means a larger enthalpy increase, therefore a higher final temperature. Now notice in this calculation, nowhere did I use the molar flow rate. The molar flow rate was 1 mole per minute. But that does not affect this problem. If it was 100 moles per minute, the answer would be the same, because this relationship that we're using here does not depend on how much we're feeding in. So that's not something we have to take into account then in this problem.